Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Mary McCallan on 2022 greenhouse gas emissions. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallan. Up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The First Minister has made tackling the climate crisis one of his top priorities. The reasons are well rehearsed, but we must always remind ourselves why this is so critical. The twin crises of climate change and biodiversity loss are among the greatest global challenges of our time. Action to address the scale and pace of the emergency is an environmental imperative, a moral necessity, an economic opportunity, and a top priority for this government. It's against this background that I update Parliament on the latest progress on Scotland's statutory climate targets. Presiding Officer, official statistics published yesterday show that Scottish emissions in 2022 have reduced by 50.0% since 1990. This is a reduction of 0.1% on our position in 21 and means we are exactly halfway to net zero. Using comparable metrics, we can see that Scotland has made the largest emissions reduction in the UK between the 1990 baseline and 2022, reducing by 50.1%, whilst emissions in England fell by 49%, followed by Wales at 36.5% and Northern Ireland at 25.9%. Scotland has also decarbonised much faster than the EU27 average, using comparable EU statistics. Despite this, today's statistics mean that we have not met the 2022 target of a 53.8% reduction from baseline. Now, some sectors saw significant reductions in 2022, including buildings, and there were more modest reductions in agriculture and industry. But there was a rise in transport emissions, particularly international aviation and shipping, resulting from a rebound following COVID-19. The 2022 data from the UK, they reflect a similar picture. Once UK data is adjusted to include international travel, which is routinely included in Scottish but not UK data, the UK also showed a 0.1% decrease in 2022, and Scotland still outperforms the UK. And certain sectors have led that decarbonisation in Scotland. Electricity supply emissions have fallen by 88.1%, industrial emissions by 56.8%, and waste emissions by 75.4% on baseline. We were among the first to take early bold action, and we're continuing to lead in responding to the climate crisis. Indeed, 63% of new woodland in the UK was created here in Scotland between 2022 and 2023, more than the other UK nations combined. And Scotland is becoming a renewable powerhouse, with more of our electricity generation coming from zero carbon sources than ever in 2022. Presiding Officer, we are now in the second half of our journey to net zero. It is more challenging, and we are abundantly clear on the need to empower individuals, communities and businesses in that journey. Indeed, in Scotland, we've enshrined in law both the need to achieve net zero by 2045 and to do so in a way that's fair. Reaching net zero is mission critical. There is no doubt of that. But we must guard against underplaying the magnitude of what's actually required to achieve it. Regrettably, in political discourse, some voices underplay the necessity of tackling climate change, whilst others will underplay the complexity of doing so. And neither of these serve as well. And for me, Presiding Officer, Scotland will always have a wholehearted commitment to delivering what we need to address the emergencies, and a determination that the transition be planned, well managed, and see our people benefit. And in Scotland, I must make clear, our task is more difficult because we lack the full powers. For example, we know that whilst our economy will ultimately benefit from decarbonisation, the upfront cost of net zero is significant. An independent analysis by the Scottish Fiscal Commission tells us that the cost is particularly high in Scotland. Despite this, the UK Government has instituted a real terms cut to our capital funding of almost 9% over 5 years. This is utterly wrong-headed and it must be reversed. Similarly, there are critical areas where the UK Government hold the power over Scotland and only they can act, but at this critical moment they're failing to do so in technologies like carbon capture and storage and in decarbonising buildings or transport at the pace required. Presiding Officer, I hope that the new government at Westminster will show greater commitment to climate change, and I'll work with ministerial counterparts to achieve progress, but we will not settle on hope alone. This is why, despite the exceptional budgetary pressures on Scotland, in this financial year alone, we're committing £4.7 billion for activities that will positively impact delivery of our climate goals. It's why legislation that is completing its parliamentary passage this week will drive forward climate progress. This includes, of course, the Agriculture and Rural Communities Bill, which passed at stage three yesterday. Scotland's farmers, crofters and land managers already play a critical role in cutting emissions, and this bill will allow them to increase their contribution whilst continuing to produce world-renowned food sustainably. Likewise, the Circular Economy Bill, currently at stage three, will provide the legislative framework to develop a circular economy alongside powers to set local recycling targets and a new code of practice for waste and recycling service. This builds on Scotland's strong record in reducing waste emissions, where the total amount of waste going to landfill has nearly halved over the past decade, and the overall recycling rate is at its highest level since records began in 2011. These bills, passing now, demonstrate that the government is acting now to make the change necessary. But we know continual challenge and progress is what the climate emergency demands of us. And so we are always looking forward, including to the complex matter of heat in buildings. Our new build heat standard currently means that no buildings constructed under a building warrant from the 1st of April 2024 will have polluting heating systems. And we recently consulted on bold proposals to end the use of polluting heating systems after 2045 and to introduce a minimum energy efficiency standard for all homes. Responses to our plans for a heat and buildings bill, which the Climate Change Committee said could be a template for the rest of the UK, are currently being analysed ahead of confirming next steps. Presiding Officer, climate change requiring everything everywhere all at once, as Antonio Guterres puts it, is why, on top of all of this work, on the 18th April I also announced a new package of climate policies. These included that we will publish a new route map for delivery of approximately 24,000 additional EV charge points by 2030, with support for rural areas and low-income groups, planning an integrated ticketing system for all modes of public transport, in agriculture, taking forward a pilot on methane-suppressing feed products and additives, and this autumn, publishing our route map to 20% reduction in car use, supporting local authorities to take action appropriate in their area. This is just some of what the government is doing, and is not to mention our biodiversity delivery plan, marine protected areas, land reform bill, our onshore wind sector deal, our hydrogen action plan, and the strategic investment in offshore wind we're currently making, which is worth up to £500 million over 5 years. As I've previously said in the Chamber, the Scottish Government recognises the Climate Change Committee's analysis this year and in 2019 that the interim 2030 target set by Parliament on a cross-party basis is beyond what can be achieved. I was not in Parliament at the time, but I share the view expressed by all parties then that setting an interim target beyond what was believed to be achievable has emphasised the importance of the journey and has helped to accelerate action in the meantime. It's certainly done that. Since 2019, we've launched the world's largest floating offshore wind leasing round. We've moved to ban some of the most problematic single-use plastics. We've restored around 75,000 hectares of degraded peatland, created 4 low-emission zones, deployed the most comprehensive network of public EV charging infrastructure in the UK outside of London, designated 37% of our waters as marine protected areas, and internationally, we've helped to break a 30-year impasse on funding for loss and damage. But just as any good climber will not be fixed on one route to a summit, we must be prepared to try new paths if experience demands it. The summit remains our goal. I will not allow it to be jeopardised by committing to a pathway that is not feasible. That's why I confirmed on the 18th of April that the government would bring forward legislation as soon as practicable to ensure that our emissions pathway takes us to 2045 on the basis of latest advice from the committee. Today's statistics reinforce what the CCC have confirmed to us in recent correspondence, namely that annual emissions and targets are highly susceptible to unexpected events. Our route to 2045 needs to be receptive to the non-linear realities of long-term decarbonisation. Consequently, our legislative proposals on new emissions reduction framework will include establishing 5-yearly carbon budgets. As the CCC recently set out to the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, annual fluctuations are smoothed within multi-year budgets, which therefore provide a more reliable indicator of progress. We're working with parliamentary authorities to ensure the bill is introduced as soon as possible after recess, and have begun engaging with the convener of the NetSet committee to support his committee's scrutiny of the bill. Thereafter, we will work towards our next climate change plan, founded on the CCC's advice on a revised pathway to 45 for Scotland. Presiding Officer, we have now reduced our emissions by 50% from the 1990 baseline, and the Government is resolutely focused on the next 50% and to achieving net zero. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. I would ask those members who would wish to ask a question to please press the request to speak button. And I call Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving us plenty of advance notice of what she was going to say today. But what an embarrassment this is for this government. The Cabinet Secretary is trying to put a positive spin on this, but it's fooling no one. The government's failed yet again to meet its greenhouse gas emissions targets. And SNP ministers have now missed 9 of the past 13 annual targets for tackling climate change. That is shocking. So you can see why they want to do away with such inconveniences. Now, the Cabinet Secretary obviously has a bit of a sense of humour. She mentions trying to find new routes to the summit. She's not even in the foothills. And if she thinks the Circular Economy Bill is going to make any difference, then she hasn't been following its progress. She has a cheek to mention woodlands when the budget for woodland planting has been cut. Domestic transport is the largest source of greenhouse gas, and emissions have gone up. So let's have a look at some of the things she mentions in the statement. A new route map for EV chargers. If you look at what the Climate Change Committee has suggested, 280,000 of those across the UK by 2030, that would amount to 30,000 roughly in Scotland, not 24,000. So when are we going to see that route map? She's got a cheek to mention an integrated ticketing system, first promised in 2012. When are we going to see that? Exactly. So how can we have any confidence at all that this government will hit the new 2045 target when they have failed so miserably?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, that was sadly a typically cynical take on an important issue, but an issue nonetheless which Graeme Simpson's party has absolutely zero credibility on. In any case, I would like to remind him that Scotland is halfway to net zero. We are ahead of the UK average, and we are ahead of the EU 27 average when we use comparable statistics. This is a record that I am extremely proud of, and I spoke in my statement to some of the interventions that the government has led that has taken us to that point. And if I can just pick up on one aspect that Graeme Simpson highlighted there on woodland creation. In the last 5 years, Scotland has created around 75% of all new forests in the UK. Of all trees going into the ground across the UK and Scotland, 75% of them have been in Scotland, sequestering carbon, supporting jobs in rural communities and feeding into our construction sector. However, the funds that the government has been able to invest in woodland creation in this financial year have been curtailed. They have been curtailed because of that up to 9% cut in our capital budget that his party in Westminster have overseen. So if he is concerned about the funding that this government has at its disposal for investment in important projects like woodland creation, I would ask him to have a word with his colleagues in Whitehall.
Thank you. And can I just say that, you know, when one member is on the floor, we don't need a whole lot of mutterings from other members from sedentary positions, not looking at anybody in particular. Thank you. I call Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance notice of her statement? The UK Climate Change Committee has been warning for years that the Scottish Government has not been ramping up the action urgently needed to tackle our climate emergency. And today's statement is, as ever, highly selective, greenwashing the SNP's achievements. It didn't mention that the SNP Government failed to deliver the £133 million it budgeted to retrofit homes, bring people's bills down and reduce their emissions. It's failed to deliver the transformation in bus services we need since the 2019 Transport Act, meaning many are forced to use cars as there are simply no affordable bus services available, and been waiting months for the Energy Strategy, the Green Industrial Strategy and the Climate Change Actions Plan. So given this is the ninth time in 13 years that the Scottish Government has failed to deliver, when are the climate activists who are angry, disappointed and worried that this continual failure leaves Scotland's credibility in serious jeopardy going to see the radical action we urgently need?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, my approach to overseeing the Government's work on climate change has always been pride in what we have managed to deliver, and I spoke to a number of the key deliverables in my statement. And I will continue to speak to them because they don't just happen. They require exceptionally hard policy development. They require the use of scarce resources. But what I have also always said is that I will never say it's enough, because the challenge of the climate emergency and the twin crisis of biodiversity decline mean that no government, no organisation, no business, no individual, really, can say that they are doing enough until, as a nation and as a community of nations, we have reached net zero and we have turned the tide on this issue. So I can commit to Sarah Boyack that the government, again, as I set out in my statement, is continuing to work across the piece, using every lever that we have at our disposal to reduce emissions with the pace that is required. And I also said in my statement how keen I am to work with an incoming Westminster government to ensure that we can collaborate across the United Kingdom. And I therefore sincerely say that I hope that when, as I think they will, Labour form the next government in England, that they will think very seriously about that £28 billion commitment that they made to investment in green energy, green activities, which appears to have been dropped, but the consequentials of which would make a big difference to the work that we can do in Scotland.
I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Maurice Golden. Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK Government have continually failed to take urgent action on reserve matters, including CCUS, hydrogen, electricity grid infrastructure and decarbonisation of gas. Not only are we dealing with the continuing constraints of devolution, but also facing severe budgetary restrictions imposed by the UK Government. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree that Scotland would be better positioned to fight climate change if it had the full powers and financial levers of an independent nation?
Yeah. Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I absolutely would. This goes to the point that I was making in my statement, which is that whilst tackling climate change is utterly critical, we do no favours to anyone by underplaying the scale of what's actually required to meet our targets. It is about transformation in every aspect of our economy and our society. And trying to deliver that as a nation when you are a devolved government is like doing it with a hand tied behind your back, particularly when in recent years the UK Government have backtracked on some critical interventions and, as I said, have cut our capital budget in the way that they have by failing to inflation-proof it. And carbon capture and storage is a really critical example of that. It is inexplicable that the Scottish cluster was not supported in track one, and it is unacceptable that now being included in track two, we are all left wondering about what progress is being made there. So I urge the UK Government to reverse Scotland's capital cut and to get a move on with the delivery of CCUS and, in particular, the Scottish cluster.
I call Maurice Golden to be followed by Audrey Nicholl. Mr Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and back to the Scottish Parliament. This repeated failure to meet emissions targets risks eroding public trust in climate action, as does the mounting list of other failed policies, all the responsibility of the Scottish Government, from recycling to renewable heat to biodiversity. Watching ministers trying to blame these failures on others instead of taking responsibility only compounds the problem. So, to ensure responsible environmental governance and restore public trust in climate action, isn't it time we had an independent environmental court in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would refer Maurice Golden to the papers that the Scottish Government recently published on the question of an environmental court, where, as we're required to do under the Continuity Scotland Act, we explored whether environmental governance would be improved or otherwise by the presence of an environmental court, and the Government's evidence on that is set out there. What I would remind him, though, is that what actually erodes public trust in climate progress, something which is very important to the public at large, is when people like Rishi Sunak, his party leader, fail to deploy onshore wind in England, whilst at the same time fight to open new coal mines and do things like create culture wars. We all remember when the Prime Minister stood outside Downing Street and, whilst dropping a raft of really important commitments in transport and heat and buildings, talked about ludicrous things like removing recycling bins and protecting people from having 6 or 7 recycling bins. That is just nonsensical. It creates culture wars and it does absolutely nothing for that hard progress that we all collectively have to work towards. And I think the public want to see us all do that.
I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Alec Rennie. Ms Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary made reference in her statement to shipping emissions. And earlier this year, Scottish Enterprise was a key stakeholder in supporting Smart Green Shipping, developers of an innovative retractable wing sail that is estimated to save commercial shipping companies up to 30% fuel per year. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree with the founder of Smart Green Shipping, Diane Gilpin, that, and I quote, there are no other countries that support innovative climate technology companies at an early stage like Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think just before coming on to the substance of Audrey Nicholl's question, I think it's a really important one for her to have raised, given that the 2022 statistics demonstrate that some of that bounce back in transport emissions were particularly from shipping. And it's worth reminding the Chamber that Scotland includes within our inventory international aviation and shipping, whereas England does not. But I do agree that Smart Green Shipping's work here is typical of the type of economic opportunity that our just transition to net zero affords Scotland as the ideal testbed for new green technology. Investment and new technology like this will help to enable companies based here to seize these opportunities and help innovative businesses grow and thrive both here at home and across the world.
I call Alec Riley to be followed by John Mason. Mr Riley.
Presiding Officer, despite the positive spin, this is a statement about failure and it should be acknowledged as such. The government in the early days, the SNP, went for the low-lying fruit, as it would be described. And indeed, the decarbonisation of electricity had more to do with Scottish Power shutting down Longannet than it was any decisions that this government actually made. Is the problem not that what we've not got from this government is joined-up policy and joined-up thinking? An example being we'll cut car kilometres by 20%, while at the same time then halting the bus partnership fund to £500 million. It's that kind of failure. So do we not need to see more joined-up government if we've ever got a chance of achieving these targets?
Cabinet Secretary.
Alec Rowley mentions the capital funding for bus partnership fund. I'm afraid that much like other capital funds with which Cabinet Secretaries had to wrestle in this year's financial settlement, it too has suffered from the up to 9% capital cut that we are facing in our budgets, thanks to the UK Government. With all due respect to Alec Rowley, I do not consider the work that the Government and the Scottish Parliament has undertaken in the last number of years since declaring an emergency as low-lying fruit. Mm-hmm. I don't consider the world's largest offshore wind, floating offshore commercial leasing round to be low-hanging fruit. I don't consider the UK's most generous concessionary bus travel scheme or the new low-emission zones or having the most comprehensive network of EV charging in the UK outside of London as low-hanging fruit. What I do accept is that the climate emergency is such that it requires continual challenge and continual work across the board. This government is determined to do that, and in particular some of the actions that we'll take forward in the climate bill will allow us to continue delivering as we have been over a number of years.
Thank you. We have got a number of members still to call, and I would like to do so, so if we could maybe pick up the pace just a little bit. And could I also just ask members to have the courtesy not to have all this muttering going on when somebody has got the floor. Thank you. I call John Mason to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. The opposition parties claim that they are interested in climate change, and yet when we come up with practical examples, as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned in her statement, say around transport, they oppose workplace parking levy, they oppose the low emission zones, and on recycling they oppose DRS. Does she find the opposition parties' attitude hypocritical or helpful?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, in the spirit of constructive working across the Chamber, I would say that there are a number of examples where cross-party working has been very successful. There are others where it has not, and John Mason is quite right to highlight them. When this Parliament in 2019 set the 75% target for 2030, one which advice told us at the time was beyond any of the five scenarios the CCC could pull together, Rosanna Cunningham, my predecessor, said to the Chamber that this would require cross-party working and a real commitment across the Chamber to pull every lever that we would have to meet these targets. Unfortunately, that has not always happened. Even modest measures that the Scottish Government has sought to bring forward have not been supported. John Mason lists some of them. And I hope that the new climate bill can be a point to reset.
I call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Lee MacArthur. Mr Ruskell.
Well, here's another practical example, Cabinet Secretary. In 2005, the Parliament's first inquiry into climate change proposed introducing road user charging with a target date of 2015. We're now 10 years on from that, and there's still no fair way to raise revenue to invest in public transport while at the same time manage down the demand for private car usage. So would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that 2022, which this statement refers to, coming out of COVID, when private car usage was so low, it was really a missed opportunity to start to break our dependency on car usage. We can't afford any more missed opportunities. All the ideas and policies are there. What's lacking is the action from councils and the Scottish Government to bring in demand management and to actually drive down emissions while driving up investment in public transport.
Cabinet Secretary, I think there was a question there.
Presiding Officer, Mark Ruskell raises an important point. Transport remains the highest emitter in Scotland. I mentioned in my statement how we will publish in autumn this year our route map to achieving a 20% reduction in car kilometres driven. The Cabinet Secretary for Transport, who's sitting beside me, is currently taking that forward. The only point I would add to that is that it's very important that as we seek to reduce car kilometres driven, we do it in a way that's locally appropriate. They're with suitable solutions for example, inner city, will be very different from those in our rural areas where the private car, an EV private car, will remain an important facet of life.
I call Lee MacArthur to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Mr MacArthur.
Thank you. Despite the spin, this statement confirms Scotland's progress to net zero is at a standstill. The Cabinet Secretary is right in her criticism of some for denying the necessity and others the complexity of achieving net zero. But given the UKCCC's repeated warnings of the need for both Scotland's governments to work together, does she believe that our chances of getting back on track are enhanced by her and her SNP colleagues making climate policy yet another constitutional battleground?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, myself and my colleagues have not and will not make climate policy a constitutional battleground. I'm afraid that our experience in recent years, and as the First Minister was reflecting this morning, particularly since the Boris Johnson government and in the years since then, there is no doubt that relations between the Scottish Government and UK Government have been poorer. I think he described it as a lack of respect, and that's coming from a man with long experience of intergovernmental relations across the UK. Regardless, I have made very clear today that I expect there will be a new UK government. I think the Tories' track record on climate change, among a plethora of other issues, will see them removed from Downing Street. And my colleagues and I will work with an incoming government, and climate change will be one of our top priorities.
I call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Ms Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know that restoring damaged peatland is a cost-effective way to reduce carbon emissions in Scotland. And earlier this month, we celebrated more than 10,000 hectares of damaged peatland restoration. However, whilst the UK Government continues to benefit from Scotland's peatlands and forestry potential, the weight still of this work still falls on Scotland. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if she agrees with me that it is only right and fair that the UK Government should contribute towards a fair funding agreement in this area?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I am a significant advocate of peatland restoration. I think it is one of the clearest win-win-wins of our journey to net zero, not only sequestering significant amounts of carbon, but creating jobs in our rural communities. And I'm really pleased that in 23-24, we restored over 10,000 hectares of degraded peatland, which was a 38% increase on what we had restored the year before. But Jackie Dunbar is absolutely right. The weight of the responsibility for payment of these areas in what we call land use change and forestry does fall disproportionately on Scotland. It's why the 9% cut to our capital budget is so damaging, and it's why I would once again urge the UK Government to reverse Scotland's capital cut.
I call Douglas Lumsden, who's joining us remotely, to be followed by Emma Harper. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. CCUS has been mentioned, and the devolved SNP Government announced £80 million in their budget over 2 years ago for CCUS, but not a single penny has been spent. So would the Cabinet Secretary not agree that the money that was pledged could be getting spent now to allow business to get ready to decarbonise? Or was this announcement of money another broken promise to the northeast of Scotland by the SNP?
Cabinet Secretary.
Another example of the brass neck of the Conservatives, I'm afraid, that Douglas Lumsden asks me a question about funding CCUS when it's his party and government who have the powers to deploy CCUS. And I think every observer, political and neutral alike, would say that their treatment of the Scottish cluster and not including it in track one and dragging their feet on track two has been utterly inexplicable. We will support the Scottish cluster and CCUS, including financially, once there is track status confirmed. I'll be waiting probably for a new government to take that forward.
I call Emma Harper to be followed by Paul Sweeney. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Under the SNP, we know that any transition to a climate-conscious Scotland is one that leaves no one behind. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that a just transition is of the utmost importance and that it must build on the voices from Scotland's communities, workers, union representatives and businesses alike, along with the voices of agriculture, including those in Dumfries and Galloway?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I absolutely do. It's why I was keen to highlight in my statement that we have two legal obligations in Scotland. One is to reach net zero by 2045. The other is to ensure that we do so via a fair transition. This means that it's well managed, that our people benefit, and that the opportunities, of which there are many, of the journey to net zero are shared. And myself and my colleagues are determinedly pursuing that.
And Paul Sweeney, briefly, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary talked about charting a new path. Well, would you not share my concern that the perversity of the biggest capital budget being allocated to Glasgow in the next few years being rebuilding the M8 motorway, whilst the public transport budget for the city has been cut to zero?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think that there are very careful, balanced considerations to make about how we invest in transport infrastructure. I know that the Scottish Government, and particularly in STPR2, has a framework through which decisions are made. Of course, we need, as I said earlier, the use of cars. I hope they will be electric vehicles, will continue to be a facet of how we travel, and we must balance that with the need for improved public transport. But I would also mention that where funding is allocated on our roads, it's very often for safety, and that remains of paramount importance to ministers.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the ministerial statement. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow front bench teams to change positions should they so wish. Thank you.